quite efficient. So first, it started 1 year ago when I started to code in Go for a project. I mostly ported all the code I've done in my Gaffer project, which is supervising things that I've written the first version in Python. And then I started to write it in Go, and should be released this week, next week. And I was considering the fact to port some part of the concurrency system since in Python, mostly because I'm tired about the current status quo. So you have G-event, you have twisted, you have eventlets, you have this new tulip based on the, which is the implementation of Guido, of the new async pip. All of these stuff are based on an event loops. So they are all using an event loops to schedule their work. All targets mostly network operations, some kind of IO, but they are all designed to do asynchronous operations for networking systems. And I wanted something really that's really oriented to implement the concurrency in Python in a simple manner with its own scheduler written in Python, everything that you can borrow to from Go. And the Go concurrency model seems to fit perfectly with Python, to Python. I will explain why. Also, I think this is probably the biggest reason. This is a good distraction for myself. This is a good reason to dive in the Golang code, source code, to understand how the scheduler works, to rewrite some parts of the algorithms and some algorithms to know how channels work, etc. It's a good distraction, at least for me. So first, I will present you how the concurrency model works, then how I implemented it in Python in my offset library, and then how I can improve that in the next version. So what's the Go concurrency model? First, everything starts from the Go memory model, which is based on CSP patterns. So mostly in Go, every process is run in a Go routines, which is a light thread. So you are, you can have multiple Go routines. Sorry. You can have multiple Go routines that can run in a thread, and there is no global variable. The coroutine doesn't know anything about each other. So when you launch a coroutine, it has its own context. You can't share a variable from a coroutine to another coroutine. While you can still have global variable in Go, this is strongly discouraged to use them, because if you are using global variable in the concurrent systems, you will have always to check what is the state of my concurrent variable and going back in the mainframe. And so you will stop any scheduling, any execution just to check the global state of a variable. So channels are the only way to communicate between coroutines and to synchronize between coroutines. You can only pass value in a channel because you obviously don't want to pass some functions over between two threads or two processes. And because sometimes you want to share multiple channels between coroutines, you can use a select to wait for one operation to come. So select is like, I don't know if you know select in Unix world, when you are waiting for readable or writable file descriptors, which can be files or just sockets to communicate. So here, instead of waiting of which one is becoming readable or writable, you are waiting for being able to sense to a value to another coroutines, or you are when you want to receive a value from a coroutines. When your channel say, I want to wait on this channel to send this value, and I want to wait on this channel to receive this value, the first time the other coroutines start to send the value, it will wake up your coroutines and you will receive the value, and then you can check the returned value by the select. I will show you an example later. And because coroutines aren't enough by themselves, you need something to schedule the works in your coroutine, just like your kernel in your operating systems is scheduling the threads to execute multiple operations at the same time. So you also need a scheduler in scope. You have mainly three entities in Go scheduler. So you have an OS thread, which is called M for machine. You have scheduler context, which is called P, mostly for process. This is the thing that will process the coroutine, and the coroutine, which are light threads. So to help the configuration in next KMA, doesn't work well. So you have a triangle that will describe the OS thread, a square describing the scheduler context, and a circle to describe the coroutines. So mostly the way the scheduler works is like this. So you have a thread that is holding context, a scheduler context. And in a scheduler context, you have one coroutine running, which is the one in orange. And you have, and it's also maintained a list of scheduled coroutines, which are put in a run queue. Each thread or M is holding one context P at a time. And at a time, you have only one coroutine that is running in the process. And the number of context or process is set by the GOMEX prof environment variable. It's by default the number of your CPUs that you have on machines, and with a minimum of one of two, I think. Can't remember. And like I said, a context maintained unscheduled works. So when you have a running, when you have a coroutine that is running, you have only one executed in one thread and held by one process. But why having context? After all, we can just have a thread and keep the scheduling queue, the run queue in the thread objects. Contexts are mostly here to allow you to handle blocking call and size call. On blocking call, a new thread will be used to maintain, to continue the scheduled process. It will take the leadership on the scheduling context, on the scheduler context, the process. And the coroutine that is blocking will continue its own execution in the thread. So everything starts with a process running a goroutine. You have an idling thread that is doing nothing. So, and when your goroutine start to block, so you can see on the right, doing a size call. A size call could be an OS read or a socket receive or a socket send, whatever is blocking in execution. So it will continue the execution in size call in the thread. And to continue the execution of other coroutine, it will migrate all the process queue, all the running queue to another thread. So it can your other coroutine can be executed while the other blocking is executing in parallel. And to make that efficient, when the coroutine is running on the thread, the Go scheduler makes sure that another thread is launched. So when you have a blocking call, you just use an idle thread. When the Go routine stop its execution, its blocking call, either it's going back in the run queue in the current thread holding the scheduling process, the run queue, or it will just be killed and garbage collected later. Thread will just continue to idle until it will be used later. So sometimes you may see the memory increase in your Go program. This is just because you have a lot of thread idling. But after a while, they are just sleeping, so it's not really a problem. And scheduler contexts are also here to help you to improve the concurrency. Like I said, you have multiple contexts maintained at the same time, each in, each in its own threads, which are always threads. And when they are started at the beginning, the scheduler makes sure that they are starting on different CPUs. So to improve the concurrency, each process, each thread in our niche process can steal the work from the other. Just like when you were at school, when you were looking on your neighbor, on the work he has done, stealing his work to improve your own work or continue your work. And this is basically what is happens with the process. So you have, at the beginning, you have a machine which have a big scheduling queue, and you have another thread with a process context, but he has no task to run, nothing. Instead of idling, he just stole the work, steal the work of the other process, keeping two coroutines executing one. So at the same time, here, because we have two process launch, we can execute two coroutines at the same time. So we have parallelization in the Go scheduler like this. Basically, the Go scheduler is working in a cooperative manner, just like G-events. When you have a coroutine, you have only one coroutine that executes, and to make sure that other coroutines will execute, the Go language has staggered some function to make sure that you can go back on the scheduler. For example, when you start to sleep on the coroutine, then this coroutine is going back in the running queue, and another coroutine will run. Or when you can force the scheduling by using the go-sched function, and then your coroutine will go back in the run queue and another will take the lead. Or when you're doing size calls, the coroutine is put out from the run queue and another coroutine will be able to run, etc. But in 1.2, that will be out at the end of the year, I think, they are adding preemption. Preemption means basically that you will be able to, that an operation will be executed for times or for a number of operations. Could be five iterations in the loops, and when you have done your five iterations, go back in the running queue, etc. So at this point, the scheduler will be able to pause any goroutines around to improve the concurrency. And it won't be cooperative anymore, but preemptive, just like your OS operating system is. How to implement that in Python? It can be tricky, mostly because you have some drawbacks in Python, and the biggest one is the GIL. The GIL is basically a way to allow all your Python code to work, to share your variables between threads in an easy manner, to make sure that you can use global variable without locking all the VM, etc. With the GIL, you have only one OS operating thread that is working at a time. So when you're launching threads in your Python program, you don't have much concurrency because you have only one thread that is executed at a time. You only adding some kind of parallelization to your program, which is quite fine when the operation that you put in your thread can work in the background, which is mostly the case for all the I/O operations, I/O bound operations. So when you're doing a socket resave, the OS will take for you the work and will does that in the background and then go back to the thread. Then you have real parallelization and you have real background works. And then threads are useful. Mostly you can use threads for any I/O operation in Python. This is very, very fine. For the rest, it doesn't give much and even it puts your code more slow. So then it could be on one thread. The other drawbacks of Python is that you don't have any byte-in operation, byte-in implementation of coroutines. Like greenlets or fibers. So you have the yield and this horrible API you can have in 4.4 with yield send, yield from. But the yield are not quite equivalent to the greenlets or to the fiber or stacklet in PyPy or stackless greenlet because they are only working on one frame on the thread. You can only put part of the stack in your thread. So you couldn't put a socket receive on that, and you can really interrupt your work. This is why the send and from exist. So I have to make some choice, and the first choice I've made is to only run one context pair Python VM. So instead of having a multi-threads maintaining multiple contexts, I have only one context in my implementations. All the coroutines are always scheduled in the main thread, and the main thread on the context. And blocking call operation, instead of blocking in the thread and launching the unlaunching a new thread to run the next coroutines and migrate the coroutines to this new thread, I just spanning a new thread, a new for IO operations. Then instead of dispatching the coroutine and let the coroutine executing in the same thread, I execute the blocking call in the thread and going back to the coroutine and putting back the coroutine in the context. So the library, my implementation is called offsets. It's compatible with Python 2.7, Python 3.3 and over, and PyPy. And you can find it on my GitHub. Why offset? Because an offset in Botanic is a small virtually complete plant that has been naturally and accessibly produced on the mother plant. Which are the small plants that here that are growing near your plants on the same plants sometimes, but that's also adding their own ADN, and this is mostly what is offset, taking the Python VM and adding some ADN from the Go language. To implement the Go routines, I'm using Python fibers. I'm not using greenlets, mostly because Python fiber, which is a new library from Sagul, which is also the author of pyuv, binding of libuv in Python, is using the stacklet code from PyPy. He just put the C code from PyPy and put his own binding for CPython on top of that. It has also the advantage that all the fiber are garbage collected instead of greenlet. When a greenlet is garbage collected, you have to make sure to exit it. If not, it won't be garbage collected. Here, the choice of fiber is to garbage collect any non-used fiber or dead fibers. In PyPy, I'm just using continuelet, so I'm not relying on any dependency. And everything is abstracted in a pros class, so I can eventually add a new feature. There is another reason why I'm not spanning threads to maintain the context. Today, when you are using Python fiber, you can't migrate fibers or coroutines from one thread to the other thread. It's locked to one thread, just like greenlets. It would be possible in PyPy because I can pickle and continuelet and post it on another thread, but we'll see later. I had a talk with Sagul about that, so maybe sometimes it will be also possible to pickle the fibers. It should be easy because it's already in the C code somehow. So in the offset scheduler, you are also free entity. You have the OS thread. I don't call it M because this is not anymore a machinery thread. This is a future we'll see later. Scheduler context, which is still called P, and P as process takes really its sense here because it's only running in one process, maintaining the scheduling queue, the run queue, and the coroutine J. The difference with the Go scheduler is that instead of having one thread maintaining a process, you have only the main thread maintaining the scheduling context, and the process is also maintaining a list of the threads running size code. So the context live in the base thread, etc. So when you have a running coroutine, this is the same, you have one coroutine running at a time in the main thread. SAS call have a different implementation. Like in Go, I had to find a way to tag some functions, some blocking function, to make sure that the scheduler know that they are SAS call. To do that, I'm monkey patching any blocking function coming from the standard library. But instead of doing that brutally, like gevent does or eventlet does, by patching the standard library and replacing any function from the standard library, I put the patch library in their own modules, patched function in their own modules, which is called syscall, just like in Go. So you can still use, if you want, the function coming from the standard library in your program, or when you want doing something non-blocking, use the syscall functions. And there will be also multi-patching function if you really want to use something like Django or anything directly with offset, without patching Django instead. So, like I said, a system call is executed in its own thread. And for that, I'm using the features from the concurrent modules, which is the new models in Python 3.3. And you can also use the concurrent modules of external concurrent module in Python 2.7 in PyPy. Future are basically a way to execute your function in a thread and waiting for the results, and when the results come back, with the result or get the error that has been thrown during the execution of your function. All features are maintained in their own pool of threads. And the number of threads is by default the number of CPUs, and you can also set it using the offset max thread of your own variable. So you can increase the number of IO threads you want to run more syscall in parallel, which is useful when you are doing a lot of networking stuff. So a blocking call is working like this. So you have a blocking call that happens on the first coroutines. And when the blocking call happens, the coroutine is put out of the run queue, a future is launched, and the future is executing the run queue, and only and the reference to the goroutine and the syscall is put in the run queue, in the dictionary. The scheduler always waits for syscall. So when you, even if you don't have any more anything, if your run queue is empty and you have syscall that have been launched, it will wait for that the syscall comes back. So you make sure that the syscall can be executed at any time. And when the syscall exits, it goes back in the scheduler, the goroutine is put back in the run queue, on top of the run queue, so it is executed in priority, and the result is returned to your function. Which means that when you do the rest read these times, it will be executed in a thread, but you won't notice that the execution of your goroutine is paused, waiting for the return of the syscall. You will just coding like you're coding every day using synchronous coding. Behind, it's executing asynchronously, but the result is waiting, and you don't notice it. Here is an example of goroutines usage. So on the left, you have the Python code. On the right, you have the Go code. What does this Go code, this Python code, sorry, is the first time in the main function, which is the first function that is executed, it launching a goroutine, which is a single function say with a string world. This goroutine with for only a goal to print world every 100 milliseconds. And so the goroutine will be scheduled when it will be able, when it will be possible. And then you execute the say function with the hello. So every 100 milliseconds, the hello is executed. And when you read the result, you have a list of hello world, fifth time. And how it's done, you can notice that you have a time slip on that, which is a time function from the offset library. And this time function makes sure that your go routine is paused and go back in the run queue. So the first time you have a hello that is printed, and the main go routine is put back in the run queue, the next one is executed and print the hello as the world, sorry, and then go back in the run queue, and the main goroutine goes back and say hello, etc., etc. And when you see on the right the Go code, which is quite the same, except the syntax a little bit. This is exactly the same things. Also, you don't have any go statement but, in Python, but should be possible. Channels are also fully implemented. How does it work is when a sender or receiver needs to wait, we put the goroutine out of the run queue. So until someone is sending a message, the receiver will be put out on the run queue. Or when someone is sending the message, it will wake up the goroutine that was receiving, putting back in the run queue, and the receiving goroutine will get the message and continue its execution, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you have also cooperation at this point. And if you see on the Python Go code, and so again, on the left, you have the Python code, and on the right, you have the Go code. So here, we are doing a sum, and to make this sum faster, we are doing it two Go routing. So we are splitting, and we are creating a chain with the make chain function. Okay, sure. Yeah. You're creating a make a channel with the make chain function. We are launching a first goroutine with one part of the array, and the channel has an argument. We are launching a second goroutine with the second part of the array, and then we are receiving the value in a x, and we are receiving the value in a y. Whatever the goroutine will return, we don't care. But here we are just stopping the execution of the main function and executing the sum. The sum takes part of the array, sum it, and send it to the channel. So the value will be back in the X the first time. The main goroutine will be put in receive mode again, and the goroutine will execute again the sum with the other part of the array, and we return it to the Y, and then we print the result, and we will have the sum. We are basically making map reduce here, where we already have the map, which is an array, doing the reduce function, which is a sum, and we are using a reduce or combine here at the end. And if you see, if you look at the Go code, which is quite the same syntax, except that we don't have any trick like in Go to have the receive and send syntax. So we are using receive and send function. But this is more Python-ish, I think. Buffered channel are also implemented. What is a buffer channel? This is basically to say, so I'm putting a size to my channel. My sender can send as many messages can until the buffer is filled. And when the buffer is filled, he's waiting that the receiver is coming. And the receiver on the other hand is always blocking, waiting a message, getting the message from the buffer. And if a sender is waiting, waking up the sender. So again, you have this cooperation working there, and which is done in this example, so in Python, on the left. You're creating a chain with a buffer of size 2. We are sending two messages. We are sending one, we are sending two. Here we are not blocking anymore. See, we are filling the buffer. And then we start to receive. It can be useful when you want to use the channel as like some queue to wait for, I don't know, connection, data, and fill rapidly your buffer. And your receiver will handle it asynchronously. And when the buffer start to be able to receive some data, wake up the sender and fill the buffer again, et cetera, et cetera. Select are also implemented too. They are working on channel or buffer channel also. And select are doing it quite simple in this final form, but it was quite complicated to get it done very fine. So in fact, how it works, the first pass, the select looks at all the operations you are waiting, if you are waiting to send to a channel or receiving from a channel. And it will like all already waiting operation. And if it's something is already waiting, it just returning the result immediately. If nothing is waiting, some data, it will put the operation on each channel in the queue of each channel. If it's a sending, it will put the operation in the sending queue and receive in the receive queue. And once someone wake up an operation, saying data or receive a message, then it will wake up the goroutine that was selecting, that was waiting for the select in an operation. And the select operation, we take the, we'll get the routine that was, the operation that was wake up, and we'll dequeue, remove the unsuccessful operation from all the channel. So you don't have any operation that is idling in the channel that could wake up later the selected. And then return the selected keys. To be more efficient, there is also a random. So when you pass the operation to the select operation, they are shuffled. So this is a random operation that will come first. So here is an example in Python. This is the Fibonacci function. Python on the left, and you have the Go version on the right. So we are creating a make channel, which will be used to send and receive data, and a quit channel, which will be used to say to stop the work at some point. We are launching first. We are launching a Go routine. This Go routine does only one thing: it is waiting for 10 value, and when it has receiving 10 value, it is telling to the main routing to quit by sending a quit. And the main routing, which is using the Fibonacci function, waiting for the possibility to send. So once so it's starting to send the X, and it's starting to send with X equals zero, and it's waiting for the quit to receive a quit. And once F has received a value, here he will receive an operation. He sends, he knows that he has sent a value, and send, increase the Y and pass the Y to the X, the Fibonacci algorithm, and then return to the loops, waiting for the next operation. And here F will receive the next operation, et cetera, print it, and send a quit at the next operation. Then at this point, the select will get the quit. And when it gets the quit, it stops to iterate and just finish the execution and return with a quit. If you see at the, on the right at the Go, the Go code, this is exactly the same modulo the syntax, but exactly the same. And the algorithm is quite the same internally. Except it's why it's written in Python. I didn't stop to implement channel scheduling and other things. I also implemented other models from the Go models. You have all the synchronous models implemented, so all mutual lock, the way to launch a function only once, or to use read and write between wall locks, so waiting for read only. Etc. Everything is implemented from the models, from the Go models. The time only implemented the function that needs to be implemented because you have a lot of function already in the standard library from Python. So I implemented the timer, which is basically a way to put your function, your Go routine out during a time and going back in your function after a time. You have a ticker, which is a channel, sending to the channel a time regularly. So you can use it, for example, to handle a timeout in your function. To handle a timeout in Go or in Offset, you're creating two channels, one channel to send data and one channel waiting for the timeout. And when you receive a timeout, just exit or do anything that you want instead of waiting for an exception, which is quite more efficient because if you were waiting for an exception, yeah, you have good chance that you will break all the schedulings in your executions. Where here you're just waiting for a channel and doing whatever you want. You have size call. For now, there are only select function because I only need that for writing polar based on KQA polar, etc., which allows me to write the net module and IO modules. So you will be able to receive and send asynchronously. The plan is to implement the dial and listen function from Go language, if you know. All the API from the net modules and the IO modules, in fact. So reader, receiver, etc. So it's, it will be ready next week. All the polling stuff is already done. What's next? Future improvements. For now, the implementation runs only in one VM, but adding the possibility to span the scheduling on the different process, OS processes this time, is quite easy. Right now, I'm creating the go routine, the fiber, or the continue let immediately and put it in the run queue. But if you want to use the still to let a process, the possibility to steal the work from another process, I will just pass just pass the function name and the argument as a tuple in the run queue for the non-executed goroutine. Then a process will be able to steal the work from the main process or another process, take the process, launch a goroutine, and once the goroutine is launched and present as a goroutine, it won't be able, it won't be migrated to another process. That's all. And for socket file operations, they will be launched in the main process, the first one, the master process. And just like in JUnicorn, I will share the socket between different processes. So you will be able to accept in any process or to send from any process, whatever you want. I probably want to remove the run command and the main task declarator that you see in the example. I think I can do just like in gevents. In gevents, it does that by putting the run loop, the event loop in its own greenlets. And when you want to schedule a function, you first put the function, you first wake up the event loop. If the event loop has some work to do, it will switch to this works. And then you put the next work in the event loop. Etc. So I think it will be able to put the run part in its own greenlets, and then when I want to schedule, switch to this run function first, put the next function to execute, the next routine to execute in the run queue, switch to the function to execute, and then go back to the run queue to execute the next one, etc. So I won't have any run. Should be possible. The other thing is today in SciSchool module, I'm using my own way to wrap and to patch the objects. And recently, Graham Doppelton, which is the author of Python Apache Mod Whiskey, has written wrapped, which is a library to patch and proxy objects in a smart way. In a smart way to do it. So instead of rewriting the well, I will just use this library. It's pretty efficient. So the first version will come this month, and you can already use it in my repository, my GitHub repo. And that's it. If you have any question.
Sorry. Do you have any questions from the floor?
Okay.
Do you have any benchmark with a typical application?
I've done some kind of benchmark, but it's not some formal. It's faster than gevent for the switching operation. And passing data from goroutines, but this is all what I done. I also done some tests to test how many goroutines I can launch, and I launched until 100,000 goroutines. So without any problem, without any problem in the recursion too, because I increase the recursion limits. Fine.
Thank you.
I would just like to ask, how does this all fit into the current concurrency ecology of Python? Because there's a lot of concurrency libraries, right? G events, diesel. Yeah. So so on. So how does offset fit into that?
So I already said I don't like the status quo you have already on the async library. And the other reason I have started to write that, there is no actually way to do asynchronous programming on Python 3 except using Tulip, which is mostly twisted, rewritten in a better way. So I wanted the same way that you can code in gevent. And gevent is pretty styled these days because he's working on his own project, so it will write its own way to work like this.
Hi, this is amazing work, I think. I've been using Go for a while, and then yeah, this looks very, very similar to the real Go code. My question to you is about the default select.
The
default select.
Yeah.
That's an important feature. Is that implemented?
Default select. I mean.
Yeah, when you have a select.
Yeah.
And then you can have a default.
Yeah.
So that.
You have also it. You can use a default object.
I see.
Default instance at least. So if you put a default instance in your select, it will return the default if there is no waiting operation.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, it's implemented.
Nice.
Do we have any other questions? Okay. So if you don't have any more, then I guess let's give a round of applause for Abhinav here.